When researchers in the field of political science and development economics look for topics to work on, we often ask, what are the biggest issues facing society and what caused them? And throughout my work in this field, I've often found that many of our biggest problems can actually be traced to the unintended consequences of policies, of decisions that had the best of intentions. Now, many people in the audience today are just preparing to begin their careers. And as you grow in your journeys, you will be making increasingly important personal decisions, business decisions, policies for organizations and for governments. So I wanted to take this chance today to tell you about how I've seen the issue of unintended consequences crop up over and over again in areas as disparate as policies to help, you know, to protect disadvantaged communities, to how to standardize local government across the country, to everyday purchasing decisions that we make as individual consumers. And because this talk is directed mainly at students, I'll draw on studies that I did when I was a student. And I hope that these examples can help to give you a framework for how you can think about the unintended consequences of decisions that you make might have. Now, the first big bit of research that I did was when I was at Georgetown with support from my advisor, Matthew Rudolph. I wanted to understand more about a political hot button in India, the issue of reservations. These are affirmative action policies to help protect groups of people who have faced historic or systematic disadvantage by giving them things like reserved spots in schools and colleges. Now, in India, as most of you know, there are many types of groups that qualify for this benefit. For example, there's the scheduled castes. These are the Dalits, the group that has faced discrimination for centuries for their so-called untouchable status. There's also the scheduled tribes. These are the tribals, the Adivasis, who face disadvantage because of their historically isolated nature. So when India achieved its independence and set about writing its constitution in 1950, many of our constitution's framers felt that the disadvantage that these groups faced ran so deep that just to be able to catch up with the rest of society, they deserved help. So it was written into our constitution that groups like scheduled castes and scheduled tribes would be allowed things like reserved spots in schools and colleges, reserved spots in government institutions, and special financial and legal support. It's a policy, it's a decision that seems very fair, and maybe it is very fair, but here is what happened. Studies that look at the merits and demerits of a policy almost always limit themselves at looking at what the policy was intended to achieve. So in the case of reservations, most studies ask, do reservations work? Do they actually help the people who avail of reservation benefits to achieve progress? Or are benefits only being cornered by the most privileged members of these groups? These are all very important questions, and different studies have found different answers. But when we look at the holistic impacts of any decision, we should spend more time thinking about what other effects can be traced back to that decision. So this is what I did, and I looked at the case of scheduled tribes in particular, because this was interesting to me because there is no hard set definition for what a group needs to be to qualify as a scheduled tribe. So there are many kinds of groups that can say that they deserve to be part of this list. Now, every so often you hear in the news, groups demanding reservations, groups demanding inclusion in the list of scheduled tribes, and this can lead to political deadlock, it can lead to animosity between groups that may not have otherwise existed, and sometimes it can lead to violence. Now, a big part of the problem is that the pie of benefits is limited. Now, I'll illustrate this with some beautiful artwork. So say, for example, the benefit that we're talking about is 100 seats in the school that are reserved for members of scheduled tribes. And suppose there are four groups that qualify as scheduled tribes. Then these 100 seats need to be split amongst the members of these four groups. But suppose... Hello? Sorry. But suppose now another fifth group comes in and says that they also want to be included in the list of scheduled tribes. And that means that now these 100 seats need to be divided amongst more people. leaving less seats for the four groups who were earlier part of this pie. So one can see how this policy specifically creates circumstances for groups to rise against each other. So it's no surprise that this kind of hostile reaction is often seen. So in my study, I looked at groups that demanded scheduled tribe status between 2000 and 2010. And I found that over 46% of groups that made these demands actually faced movements by other groups against them making these demands. And you can read more about specific examples of how this has led to violence and conflict. So when we think about the impacts a policy has or will have, we should think about the incentives that that policy creates for the people that that policy covers and for the people that the policy leaves out. But we should also think about the environment in which that policy is going to operate. So in India, we have a first-past-the-post electoral system in which politicians do not need a majority of votes to win. So it can actually be sound political strategy to please and pander to a small particular group. Worse yet, it can even be in the interest of a particular politician to create or to inflame such demands so that they can stir up emotions and fights and then come in as the beacon of hope that promises to support a community in its demands. And this can lead to a cycle. Demands are made by communities, demands are championed by politicians, and seeing these demands, many other groups get up and then make their own demands, saying that they also need this benefit in order to compete. And you know, this is reflected in our study where we found that about a quarter of the groups that demanded scheduled tribe status actually used previous inclusions of other groups that had also been given this benefit to make their own demands. And again, this is reflected in the fact that even though reservations were meant to be for exceptional circumstances, today over half the population of India is actually entitled for some kind of reservation benefit. And there are other related elements that also reinforce divides. For example, there was a Supreme Court ruling that held that the children of a tribal woman but a non-tribal man cannot claim the benefits of scheduled tribe status. Now, in a country where we already have so many divisions, instead of trying to make our similarities more relevant and more powerful than our differences, we've actually created a policy that gives people new reasons against coming together, for fear that future generations may lose out on some special government benefit. Now, reservations is a very complex issue, and I am not here to give a definitive opinion about how they should be managed. But I would like to emphasize this as an important example of how we need to think about the unintended consequences of policies that we make. We need to think about the incentives that they create for the people the policy covers and for the people that the policy specifically leaves out. And we need to think about what social, political, economic environment that policy will operate in and what snowballing effects that might set off. Now, this policy has actually reversed some behavior. In pre-independence census enumerations, groups used to clamor to claim that they belonged to higher level castes so that they could get better social standing. Fast forward to today, and the Supreme Court of India has observed, nowhere else in the world do castes queue up to be branded as backward. Nowhere else in the world is there a competition to become backward. Now I'm going to skip forward to another research project that I did. This was work that I did at Cornell, where I worked with advisors Arnab Basu and Nancy Chow. I had come across a surprising fact that even by conservative estimates, about half of the urban cities and towns in India are governed by rural local governments, that is by panchayats, instead of by urban local governments, which is some form of municipality like they're meant to be. So for example, think of a city. And the problem is that that city is being run by a panchayat instead of by a municipality. And this is very prevalent across the country. So I wanted to understand how this came to be and whether this was a problem for development. And it was no surprise that this could also be traced to unintended consequences of a decision that, when seen in a particular context, could seem to be very sound. And to understand it, we once again need to go back to when India set up its first constitution in 1950. Back then, the constitution detailed two levels of governance, which we all know. There's the central government, and below that, every state has a state government. But what about all those panchayats that take care of villages and all those municipalities that take care of cities? That third level of government is known as local government, and that was more or less left for the states to manage. And the way that states managed them varied a lot. And as you can imagine, there were problems. So for example, in the state of West Bengal, universal adult franchise was not introduced until the 1960s. So for so many years after we got independence, the basic democratic principle of every adult being allowed to vote in his or her local election was not in place. There were problems in other states as well. So for example, in Rajasthan around the 1970s, local elections were very irregular, with even major hubs like the capital city of Jaipur not having elections for close to 20 years. And these are big problems to have in a democracy. So one can understand why many of India's lawmakers felt that they needed to step in and formalize this third tier of local government. That would help ensure that no matter where you were in the country, every Indian would have more or less equal access to democratic institutions. But when you formalize something, what that means is you need to give it a set of rules, certain powers and certain responsibilities that these local governments would have. But how can you have the same set of rules for a tiny village and the same set of rules for a booming metropolis like Mumbai? I mean, surely Mumbai's local government would need to be more complex. It would need to take care of things like slum areas, public transport, providing fire service, and would also need more power, like being able to collect more taxes, so that it can provide the infrastructure that a city needs. So our constitution was amended in the 1990s, and the third tier of local government was given some form. And because the needs of small rural areas are different from the needs of big urban areas, there would be two types of local government: a rural local government and an urban local government. And since India is a federal government that empowers its states, in the spirit of democracy, states would get to decide which places would get rural and which would get urban local governments, keeping in mind the circumstances of each state. Again, it's a decision that, when seen in this light, seems to make a lot of sense. But we also need to consider what new status quo any new decision, any new policy puts in place. Because this will create a new set of winners and losers. And that is going to create its own set of incentives. So let's think about some of the incentives that can help explain why so many of India's urban areas are governed as though they were rural. There are widespread perceptions that in rural local governments, taxes are lower, government regulations are more lax. There are also many government allowances and schemes that are available either exclusively only to rural local governments or only to urban local governments. So citizens and politicians might advocate for the form of local government that has access to schemes that they are interested in. And there's also just the general problem of inertia, because the default categorization of most settlements is rural. Changing to urban local government requires political will, time, money, resources, so many places just won't take the trouble to do it. And this has real development costs. In our study, we found that when an urban area has a rural local government instead of an urban one, that's associated with that place having poorer urban amenities. Things like less roads, poorer access to a fire station, drainage, less water storage capacity, things that are really important for an urban area to chug along. So not accounting for unintended consequences that a decision could have, especially when it can be foreseen by just considering the incentives that it creates and the environment that it operates in, that can really stand in the way of development. Now I'm going to skip forward to the work that I'm doing today. I'm not working on a research project full time. Instead, I'm working on a social enterprise called SaltScout, where our mission is to nudge people to think more about the broader social aspects of all their spending decisions. We do this through things like charity sales of memorabilia and through special product lines with compelling stories behind them. For example, we're working with this amazing group called Ocean Soul, and we've brought that concept to India for the first time. And what I love about their work so much is that it displays real creativity in not only serving as a reminder to think about your unintended consequences, but it actually takes the unintended negative consequences of other people and turns it into something beautiful. Now have a look at these sculptures. Aren't they gorgeous? So these are all handcrafted. But what makes them so special is not just their artistry. These are made out of recycled flip-flops, rubber chappals that were polluting the oceans. These chappals have been retrieved, cleaned, and then carved into this, making something that is beautiful in its own right, but also making something that saves the planet by mitigating the unintended consequences of other people. After all, we've all bought flip-flops and we weren't being evil citizens who were deliberately polluting the oceans and endangering lives in the sea when we did that. But this is something that can inspire you, something that can make you think a little bit more the next time you want to go out and buy rubber chappals. And if we all aspire to this level of ingenuity, then our future can definitely be this bright. Thank you.